Good evening. Thanks for joining us at St. Mark's here in North St. Paul this evening. This is our midweek Lenten service, and during this season of Lent, our theme has been encounters with the sacred. On Sunday mornings, we've been looking at biblical stories of people's encounters with Jesus, and on the Wednesday evenings, different people from our congregation have spoken to us of their own sacred encounters, encounters with people, events, places that have maybe challenged, changed their lives, set them on a new path. Tonight, I'm grateful and I'm happy that we have with us Paige Erickson. We'll be preaching, sharing something from her life and her heart. Paige is a student at the University of Wisconsin in Montreal. Currently not able to be at school, so that, you know, life has gotten a little rocky stormy there for Paige. She'll tell you more about that in her message. Paige is also the daughter of Mike and Suzanne Erickson, who are very active involved members here at St. Mark's. So we gather together. We come together this evening to reflect on God's word, God's word for the world. And I'm glad you are here. I welcome you along with God, the one, the Holy, who we have come to call you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Sound of your name. compares to the promise I have in you. Shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the work of your hand. Forever I'll love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have in you. In you.
The scripture passage I chose for today is from Mark, chapter 4, verses 35 to 41. That day, when evening came, he said to his disciples, "Let us go over to the other side." Leaving the crowd behind, they took him along, just as he was in the boat. There were also other boats with him. A furious squall came up, and the waves broke over the boat so that it was nearly swamped. Jesus was in the stern, sleeping on a cushion. The disciples woke him and said to him, "Teacher, don't you care if we drown?" He got up, rebuked the wind, and said to the waves, "Quiet, be still." Then the wind died down, and it was completely calm. He said to his disciples, "Why are you still afraid? Do you still have no faith?" They were terrified and asked each other, "Who is this? Even the wind and the waves obey him." So a few years ago, I woke up and I was in an SUV at 2 a.m. in Michigan in the middle of nowhere. And I stumbled my way out of the car, across the camp, threw myself in a bunk that literally sagged underneath my weight. I had no idea what I was about to encounter. I didn't expect much more than camp food, hikes, some worship, maybe even a Bible study. But I'd like to think of the disciples in the passage that similar to how I did. In verses 35 to 37, it says, "That day, when the evening came, he said to his disciples, 'Let us go over to the other side.' Leaving the crowd behind, they took him along, just as he was, in the boat. There were also other boats with him." They were in the darkness with some idea of where they were going, but with a disorientation of the journey. I feel like for most people, change is dizzying. Sometimes it throws you off. Small journeys are going to be one camp aren't too hard to get used to once you have some sleep, but things like moving across the world, living and working from home for the first time, or the journey of life can be so confusing a hundred checklists to prepare for. Yet, through all the confusing time, we see Jesus, just as he was. I love that phrase for the simplicity of who Jesus is. He is such an unassuming power. It is so invisible to the disciples who see him as the man he was. They know he has power, but they forget how great it can be, and that it is so much more than just a man. As much as I want to say that I see Jesus' power now and understand what it is and what it means to me, that isn't true. I am continually amazed by the stories in the Bible, the displays of his power, and the absolutely amazing things he's done and continues to do. However, I often put Jesus into a box. One of the possible. I think that he can only do so many things, that he can save me from my sins, but that I can deal with my problems, my stresses, my selfish things that I need to do. I limit the amount of power that Jesus has in my life. Even now, while giving this message, I still do this, I'm asking my myself to expand my box, to make it bigger, bigger, bigger than even I can comprehend. While I was in Michigan, I was participating in soccer focus week, or CFW, with my college friends at a Christian organization at the University of Wisconsin Fort Myers School. We did a small group leader training, worship together, and dug through passages like this one, work, and games of volleyball and football. The campus situated in the Upper Peninsula of Michigan, and was split between two lakes, so no matter where you looked, there was always water. I did my own personal reflection or quiet time, studying Mark with my coffee, staring at the water and the Adirondack Shore. For some of you, this may sound amazing, yay vacation, but for me, it was uncomfortable. I had been struggling with my quiet times for months while my friends continued to share about how much they were expanding my faith. I would sit there every morning and read about how others saw Jesus' great power and believed in him, and my trust in that healing. I prayed to God that I could finally get out of my own weeds, my own drowning, my struggles in life, and trust that he was going to keep me from coming back in. Each day was an agonizing self-discovery, and a sharing with others, man, did I seek that trust. But bit by bit, it wasn't as hard as the day before. I realized that there were so many others who didn't feel as connected to God, similar to myself. And I began to enjoy my time in the morning, looking at the waves and getting deeper into the wind. My heart began to change and open up. And what I knew all along on the side of our Christ began to change how I felt about it. Yet, even all of this, I still didn't get how absolutely great God is. I was beginning to think that I wasn't quite there yet. So, I knew that he created the universe and sent his son Jesus, but I didn't get the impact in my life at times. Facing my own life struggles like new friends, college classes, a new stressful job, and the uncertainty of the future, I think I would have responded the exact same way that the disciples did in verse 37. It says, "A furious squall came up, and the waves broke over the boat so that it was nearly swamped. Jesus was in the stern, sleeping on a cushion. The disciples woke him and said to him, 'Teacher, don't you care if we drown?' Everyone has storms inside of them, or in their lives. Some may be bigger than others, but I think all of us are forever drowning, and our boat is about to sink at one point in time in our lives. Most of you probably feel that right now. And society is changing. It is so easy to see the waves, the wind, the storm in our lives. We feel ourselves running out of air and only focus on how God isn't putting us on solid ground. So we begin to pray. But even God has an answer to our prayer. In Philippians 4, verses 6 to 7, it says, 'Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus.'" I think all of us, including the disciples, could take some time to reflect a moment. Their first response in that boat wasn't to pray, to give thanks, to thank to God. Instead, they accused Jesus of not caring for them, of not having the power to control the storm. If you don't have a storm currently brewing in your life right now, with everything that's going on, I commend you. However, if you, like me, are currently anxious about everything and doubting what God is in this time, think if you've presented your request. If you've prayed or given thanks when you haven't prayed for that, there's something to be thankful for. And I originally agreed to get this message. I thought I would be speaking about giving up control to God during my day-to-day lives. And the busyness, the stress, the change of the future, especially myself as a student. However, nothing prepared me for standing before God and giving up complete control of my entire future. From seeing friends every day to living with my parents full-time, knowing that my situation is one of privilege and compassion to so many others, I have the opportunity to live with my strength and friends. Yet even in my ways make me feel like my life is on its side, Jesus says he ready to take the in verse 39, it says, he got up, rebuked the wind, and said to the waves, quiet, be still. Then the wind died down, and it was completely calm. God's power that he gives to his son is so great that the storm died right then. It didn't subside or diminish, but it died, so it was completely calm on the lake. When we say all of us should live a calm life, we also know God will provide and protect us in storms. Maybe not when we want it, or when we expect it. Maybe he already has and we didn't even notice it. But he will provide. We just have to have faith and pray and expectation for when that peace will come. Jesus asks his disciples in verse 40, why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith? Right now, we try to remind each other to have faith. But back when I was up at camp in Michigan, I was wondering what faith was. I was afraid of letting go and giving up control to God, but I felt a part of myself back for a long time. Like a black pit in my heart that was just for me and not for God to take it over. But what I didn't understand is that a half-hearted faith is not faith at all. The week I spent learning to trust God in a time of turmoil in my life was hard, but not as hard as what I found on the right end. When I gave my life to God at the end of the week, the messy parts, the crazy parts, the parts I refused to acknowledge to myself, all of it. It was so because He has the power to control the storm in my life and the storm in everyone else's. His power is so great that it's my head on it. I may never be able to get how big it is, but I try and the fact that I eventually will. Although at least I know that the disciples at the time didn't quite get it either, so I guess that's comforting. In verse 41, it says, they were terrified and asked each other, who is this? Even the wind and the waves obey him. Maybe that's why I can't define God's plan much more than greater than you can imagine. Because it's scary to think of someone controlling the entire universe we live in. But in a weird way, it's almost comforting to know that a God that can do all those things cares enough about our tiny existence to calm our storms. There's an idea our society seems to have about controlling our destiny. The more control you have, the better off you are. It took God many years of reminding me, prodding me, putting me in situations that challenged me, to get me to finally realize that giving up control to God is the best way to control His hope for the world. I gave up my control to God for the first time in Michigan, and finally started to understand what really having faith means. And this is by no means a one-and-done type of thing, but the reward is worth it. Giving up control will always be something I need in so many others that I want. But God will provide. Like it says in Philippians 4:7, and the peace of God which transcends all understanding will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. God has us when you have the faith to let Him take the reins. Whether it's a sinking ship, like cabin full of college kids, or right here in your home, He will provide because only He has the power to. I hope you're all doing well for this tumultuous time, and I hope you'll take this time of distance to give God control of your storms. Some action steps you can take while keeping others around you safe by praying with family members or friends in person or through video chat on the storms that you're trying to weather without God. Another example of this is going to the resources section or Fitness website for updates, devotionals, and previous messages to get caught up. God will take care of us and He will control our souls as long as we are around. What do you pray for me? Hey God, I want to thank you for today, for this time with the Church NSP community, for letting me speak on your behalf. And God, I want to pray that you are with all of these people as they are letting those things with you, God, that you are able to be a part of each and every one of their lives, and that they're able to let you in. God, we love you, and though we may feel lost right now, we know that you will always be with us to provide and find us for us.
I am His.
Keep watch, dear Lord, with those who work or watch or weep this night. And give your angels charge over those who sleep. Tend the sick. Give rest to the weary. Bless the dying. Soothe the suffering. Comfort the afflicted. Shield the joyous. And all for your love's sake. Amen. And now my gifts are going to be finished. By your hand may love be saved. By your voice may peace be spoken. By your eyes may beauty be seen. By your ears may truth be heard. And by your lips may the song of Christ